Hi, I'm Dr. Deepa. Welcome to my channel Together and Fun. Silk Road by Nick Middleton. About the author. Nick Middleton is an award-winning geographer, writer, TV presenter, environmental scientist, and university lecturer. He was born in 1959 in London, England. His curiosity about how planet Earth works and how people interact with it was fueled from an early age. Now he works and communicates on a wide variety of environmental issues and travel topics for a broad range of audiences, from government policy makers to primary school children. He also teaches at the University of Oxford, where he is a fellow at St. Anne's College. Nick is the author of 7 travel books, including the bestseller Going to Extremes, which accompanied a television series he wrote and presented for Channel 4, a National Geographic channel on extreme environments and the people who live in them. His TV documentaries have been broadcast all over the world and his book translated into more than a dozen languages. Introduction. This article gives an account of a journey from gently rolling hills of Ravu to Mount Kailash. The narrator wanted to complete the Kora at Mount Kailash. Lamo gave him a long-sleeved sheepskin coat to keep him warmer. He hired Satan's car and took Daniel as companion for escorting him to Darjeeling. He seems a lover of adventure who is not at all afraid of taking risks. Let's look into the summary. The narrator and Satan took a shortcut to get off to Changtang. This route would have taken them southwest, almost directly towards Mount Kailash. It involved crossing fairly high mountain passes. Satan said that there would be no problem if there was no snow. This shortcut took them across vast plains across the arid pastures. They saw a few gazelles and a great herd of wild asses. As hills came once again, they passed shepherds tending their flocks. The narrator and Satan passed the dark tents of the nomads in a lonely place. A huge black dog, a Tibetan Mastiff, would stand to guard outside. These dogs raised their big heads erect and watched the narrator's car. As the car came closer, they would start barking and ran towards their cars. The dogs would stop barking only after chasing them off the property. Then they entered a valley. The snow-capped mountains were visible on the horizon. The river in this valley was wild and mostly blocked with ice. Gradually, they gained height and the valley sides closed in. They were climbing up the hill. The turns became sharper and the ride bumpier. Satan drove in a third gear. The narrator felt the pressure building up in his ears. He held his nose, snorted, and cleaned them. They were at 5,210 meters above the sea level. Satan grabbed handfuls of dirt and flung it across the icy top layer. Then they drove the car slowly and carefully on the icy surface. They continued to climb in the bright sunshine. They crept past 5,400 meters. The narrator's head began to throb horribly. He took gulps from water bottle. Finally, they reached the top of the pass at 5,550 meters. The lower atmospheric pressure was allowing the fuel to expand. This could be dangerous, so Satan advised them to smoke. As they moved down the other side of the pass, the narrator's headache soon cleared. It was 2 o'clock. They stopped for lunch. By late afternoon, they had reached the small town of Hoor. They were back on the main east-west highway. It followed the old trade route from Hazar to Kashmir. Daniel got a ride in a truck to return to Hazar. Satan got the puncture tires repaired. The narrator found Hoor a grim, miserable place with no vegetation. They had tea in Hoor's only cafe. They left Hoor after half an hour. They drove towards Mount Kailash. After 10:30 p.m., they drew up outside a guest house in Darjeeling. One of the narrator's nostrils was blocked again. He was tired, hungry, and gasping for breath. He could feel better when he sat up. He stayed awake all night. The following morning, Sedan took him to the Dachan Medical College. The doctors felt the narrator's pulse and gave him medicines for cold and exhaustion due to altitude. The narrator slept soundly at night. After first full day's course of medicines, when he recovered, Satan left him as he had to return to Haza. Dachan had some simple general stores selling Chinese cigarettes, soaps and supplies of food. Women washed their long hair in the icy water of a narrow brook near the guest house. There were no pilgrims. Dachan had only one cafe. He met Nobu there. He was a Tibetan, but worked in Beijing at Chinese Academy of Social Science. In the Institute of Ethnic Literature, he could speak English. He too had come to the Kora. Nobu was very fat. He found it very hard and tiresome to walk or go up. The narrator decided to make the trek into the company of Nobu instead of waiting for the devout believers. They hired yaks to carry their luggage. Nobu said that he had no intention of prostrating himself all around the mountain. It was not possible for him as his tummy was too big. If you are watching this channel for the first time, subscribe. If you like the content, click the like button and share. If you want to watch more of these videos, enable the bell icon. Thank you.